Love. Something here. Yes. Okay. One more time. Let's do it a little bit quicker this time. All right. Go through it a little faster.
Stop and let me tell you what the Lord has done for me. Stop and let me tell you what the Lord has done for me. He forgave my sin and he saved my soul. He cleansed my heart and he made me whole. Stop. And let me tell you what the Lord has done for me.
Stop!
There we go. Got it. All right.
If we'd all stand to honor the reading of God's word as they did in the Old Testament times, and we'll read this parable of the prodigal son. It's obviously has a lot in it. So Luke chapter 15, verses 11 through 32. And he said, a certain man had two sons, and the younger of them said to his father, Father, give me the portion of goods that falleth to me. And he divided unto them his living. And not many days after, the younger son gathered all together and took his journey into a far country, and there wasted his substance with riotous living. And when he had spent all, there arose a mighty famine in that land, and he began to be in want. And he went and joined himself to a citizen of that country, and he sent him into his fields to feed swine. And he would fain have filled his belly with the husks that the swine did eat, and no man gave unto him. And when he came to himself, he said, how many hired servants of my father's have bread enough and to spare, and I perish with hunger? I will arise and go to my father, and will say unto him, Father, I have sinned against heaven and before thee, and am no more worthy to be called thy son. Make me as one of thy hired servants. And he arose and came to his father. But when he was yet a great way off, his father saw him, and had compassion, and ran, and fell on his neck, and kissed him. And the son said unto him, Father, I have sinned against heaven, and in thy sight, and am no more worthy to be called thy son. But the father said to his servants, bring forth the best robe, and put it on him, and put a ring on his hand, and shoes on his feet, and bring hither the fatted calf, and kill it, and let us eat and be merry. For this my son was dead, and is alive again. He was lost and is found, and they began to be merry. Now his elder son was in the field, and as he came and drew nigh to the house, he heard music and dancing. And he called one of the servants, and asked what these things meant. And he said unto him, thy brother is come, and thy father hath killed the fatted calf, because he hath received him safe and sound. And he was angry, and would not go in. Therefore came his father out, and entreated him. And he answering said to his father, lo, these many years do I serve thee, neither transgressed I at any time thy commandment, and yet thou never gavest me a kid, that I might make merry with my friends. But as soon as thy son which was come, which hath devoured thy living with harlots, thou hast killed for him the fatted calf. And he said unto him, son, thou art ever with me, and all that I have is thine. It was meet that we should make merry and be glad, for this thy brother was dead, and is alive again, and was lost, and is found. Amen.
Let's pray together. Father, as I come to you, I thank you for being here with us, for without you, this is just a waste of time. And Lord, you know that you've said in your word that we must worship you in spirit and in truth. So, Father, I ask again for the power of the Holy Spirit, not only in my preaching, but in the hearing of the Word of God. And, Lord, if we have thy Holy Spirit and we handle the truth of your Word the correct way, then, Lord, you're going to be blessed and our people are going to be blessed. And that's what we need today. Please, Lord, help Dave. He's not well enough to be here today. Just uplift him. Lord, we miss some of the children that normally would come. Yeah. I pray that you might bless in their life. Thank you, Marissa's feeling good enough to be with us today. Yes. And just continue to help her. And thank you also for taking care for Raph these weeks and give him more work, please, yes. Soon, Lord. And I pray that you'd use all of us, that we might be good witnesses, that we'd understand what these things have, that we have here in this passage, that we might tell others. So please help us. We love you and we thank you in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
Thank you. You may be seated. I've been praying earnestly about what to preach, and of course we're going through the book of Luke, and you know I want to go on in the book, and eventually we want to finish it before Jesus Christ comes, takes us all out. I'd like to be able to do that. But we never know. We'd let him teach us the rest of it if I don't. Amen? But, you know, this is a lengthy passage. We've got, quite a few verses here. What would that be, 21 verses or so that we have? And I preached some on it last week, and God said, preach some more on it. And so that's what I want to do. Now, I remember that this parable is to show us, as the parable of the lost sheep and also the parable of the lost coin, that we're lost. I hope you get the idea that, you know, there's a lostness here. And we're lost to God's family. We're lost to God's house. We're lost to the heaven that God created us to be in. And that's what's going on here. And that we need to be saved from the hell that we deserve. That's what a lot of people don't realize. We go around telling people, you need to be saved. They don't know what from. Right. I'm not in any danger. You know, the car hasn't flipped over and it's on fire. You know, no, you got a worse thing facing you than that. And we also see in this how much rejoicing God entertains when one is found and repents. What a great thing that is.
Amen.
And we need to be excited as well with it. The conversion of sinners is his supreme intent. And those that come to Jesus are rewarded beyond earthly means. That we get in this. Now, this son had already spent everything, and yet when he comes back, the Father, you know, just pours out on him so much. It's incredible. Another thing that we gain here in introduction to all of this, another thing that we see, is that the religious and self-righteous of any era don't want any part of God's work.
Amen.
That comes out in Scripture from the beginning to the end of this book, of not just the Gospel of Luke, but in Genesis to Revelation. The idea of God's work of redemption, that people need to repent and then by faith trust Jesus Christ as Savior, they don't like that. You see, they'd rather have their good works, that's the only thing they believe counts and merits before God, is what they're doing. And Lord willing, I don't know if it'll be this Sunday, next Sunday, this is going to be one of those, you know, I guess you'd call it a bologna sandwich, you know, I can just cut it wherever I want to and you'll be fed enough and we'll just go on from there. I've got here enough to last about 6 hours. Yeah, so, you know, but I'm not going to preach that long. Don't panic, you know. Don't send out for, pizza to be delivered or anything, you know. I'm not going to go that long. But God just pressed on me, do this. And I went through and just kept working and working and working and working and working. And he said, that's what I want you to do. So I said, all right. One of the things that I want you to understand this morning is that the parable here presents God as a common father. Look with me, if you would, in the book of Malachi. That's right before Matthew, so just the next book toward the Old Testament is the prophet Malachi, chapter 2 and verse number 10. Malachi chapter 2 and verse number 10. And we read this, Malachi 2:10. Have we not all one Father? And I suppose if you want, we can trace that all back to Adam and Eve. You know, we have one Father. Have we not all one Father? Hath not one God created us? I hear people turning still. Malachi 2:10. Why do we deal treacherously, every man against his brother, by profaning the covenant of our fathers? You know, why is it that mankind's so terrible toward mankind? It just amazes me. I was just reading this week that Buddhists in Burma, okay, in what's Burma, now they call it Myanmar, the Buddhists there have decided they're not going to let the Muslims take over their country and they're going to destroy them. The Buddhists, who are normally thought of as pacifists and all that kind of thing, one of their leaders calls himself the Bin Laden of Burma. And they're going to take out those Muslims. Why do men fight like they do? I mean, just incredible, isn't it? But, you know, one God created us. And then turn with me, if you would, to the book of Romans, chapter 3 and verse 29. Book of Romans, chapter 3, verse 29. And here's what God's word tells us there. If you found your place in Romans 3, 29, say amen if you have. Amen. It says this, is he the God of the Jews only? You know, isn't it something? You know, Allah is only the God of the Muslims, not anybody else. The God we love and serve is the God of everyone. Is he not the God of the Jews only? Is he not also of the Gentiles? Yes, of the Gentiles also. You know, the Heavenly Father is the Father, a God of all of us. And we have to remember that kind of thing. But coming back to Luke chapter 15, I want you to understand this. The parable presents mankind as different, yet still sinners. We've got two sons. Luke chapter 15, verse 11, a certain man had two sons. He's got two sons, and the two sons are very different. One is sinful on the outside. We can see that easily. One is sinful on the inside. Don't see it quite as easily, but he is. Now, folks, I'm going to make a statement here. I don't think you're going to like it. We are all sinners, every one of us. Some of us show it more than others, but we're all sinners. Some of us show it more repulsively than others, but we're all sinners. And that's what this book shows us here. That's what this parable is showing us, that we're all sinners. So take a look, if you will, here. We start in Luke chapter 15, verse 12, and it says, and the younger of them. So I want to look at and focus on this morning the younger son. I titled the message, The Riotous Living here, and I'm not going to teach you how to have riotous living. You know, that's not my intent this morning. I wanted to steer you away from it. Amen. All right? That's what I'm hoping. And what I see happening in this passage of Scripture with the younger son is all extravagant. That's a great big word. E-X-T-R-A-V-A-G-A-N-T, extravagant. And that's what prodigal means. Prodigal means extravagant wastefulness. And so we're going to see extravagant here. So look with me, first of all, the younger son was extravagant in his riot and raucous living. His riotous and raucous living. And we started out here with his rude request. We looked at this before. And verse 12 says, and the younger of them said to his father, Father, give me the portion of goods that falleth to me. And he divided unto them his living. And remember last week we talked about how that was a terrible thing to say to your dad. Dad, I wish you were dead. Give me my inheritance now. You know? Really, what's going on here is, first of all, he was weary of his father's rule. He was weary of his father's rule. We don't like it when we have somebody telling us what to do. I mean, a nice summer day like today, let's just pretend that you are driving along in a convertible, the wind's blowing in your face and your hair, and it's just wonderful, you know, and, you know, it just, you know, just put the pedal to the metal, and why is that sign say 35? You know, I wish I could move to where you could go whatever speed you want, over there in Germany, right, Raph? You know, why do we have to have that speed limit? Yeah. Why did the policeman pull me over? Because I got bald tires. Who cares what my tires look like? You know? Why do I have to wear a motorcycle helmet? Why do I have to do this? Why do my kids have to have a helmet on to ride their bicycle? You know? Man. Rules. Everywhere you look, there's rules. We get weary of the Father's rule. How about all those commandments? Thou shalt not, thou shalt not, thou shalt not. come on, Lord. Yeah, we get weary of the father's rule. And so he wanted out from under him. Isn't that true? It's what he wanted to do. Give me the money. I'm going to make my own. I'm going to go on my own way, do my own thing. I don't be under your rule anymore. You know? It's what he wanted. You know, he also here, a second thing that he sort of is saying in verse 12 is that he distrusted the father's management of his wealth. You know, Father, give it to me now, because I don't know what you're going to do with it later. I mean, you might become a poor man and I got nothing. You know, so I want it now. Now, we're a now generation anyhow. Everybody wants it now. We don't want to save for it, wait for it. You know, give it to me now. And the credit card companies love that. Amen. Sure, we'll give you credit for that. You know, you want it now? Sign right here. Yeah, well, this will work. We want it now. And so he's saying, I don't think you can handle all this. You know, sometimes we say that before God. God, I don't think you can take care of my life as good as I can take care of my life. That's not a good thing. And of course, obviously then, if he wanted all that money, he must have been proud of his own management of money. He must have thought he could do a lot better job. Yeah. But what we see here is that after he got the money, you know, he wasted his substance with riotous living, and when he had spent all, verse 14 says, that didn't do him any good. I worked with a fella that his grandmother died, and he didn't even realize his grandmother had all kinds of money, left it to him. And the guy, I mean, he's a smart enough guy, but, you know, he's never really had money, never knew what to do with money, and you know, the boss man said to him, look, I'll invest that for you, and it'll pay you years and years and years and your retirement and all that kind of thing. And he said, no, I've been wanting this and wanting that, and it wasn't but 2 months later he had it all gone. We read that kind of thing about lottery winners too, don't we? Oh boy, it's riotous living. But let me go on to something else here. Secondly, we see that the younger son's father was extravagant. And of course, verse 12 says, and he divided unto them, the two boys, unto them his living. He just divided the whole thing up. Now, why would the father do that? Now, think with me, if you will, that the picture here is that this is also God the Father. So the first reason why he did this was he was willing to show his kindness. And we see here that this is a kind thing to do to the boy. He didn't have to do it. He could have said, wait till I die. You know, you're just going to have to wait. You know, get in line, you know, and just wait. But no, he did this to show his kindness. Doesn't God give to us and do for us and all these blessings upon us to show his kindness over and over? You see, so many people think that God is just sitting up in heaven with a big club ready to back them on the head if they do something wrong. And yet God just over and over and over and over again is kind to us, kind to us. You know, everybody that's listening to me that lives in the United States of America ought to be thanking God we've got born here and are able to live here. Yeah. We hardly ever thank him for that. I mean, all the bounty that we have, all the things we have. Just incredible. Because God wants to show his kindness over and over to us. Because his kindness is, lead us to repentance. He does that. But he also, the Father did this to show the Son his own foolishness. I don't know where it came from, but there were days when I don't know exactly what bad things I was doing. I know that none of you can imagine me ever being a bad child growing up. But my mom would say to me at times, you know, if I gave you a rope, you'd hang yourself with it. And she wasn't talking about, you know, suicide. She was talking about you'd just get yourself into more trouble than, you know, if I let you go far enough, you know, I'd give you enough. God, a lot of times, would just give us, do for us, just to show our own foolishness. You know, he gave him all that, and the boy went out and they blew it all. Riotous living, just blew it all. What good did it do him? Showed his foolishness. But let me go on here to a third extravagant, if I could. The younger son was extravagant in his self-indulgence. He was extravagant in his self-indulgence. We read in verse 13, and not many days after, the younger son gathered all together and took his journey into a far country, and there wasted his substance with riotous living. Extravagant in his self-indulgence. And so I want us to understand the sinful state is a departure and a distance from God. You notice that he gathered all and went into a far country. The sinful state is a departure and distance from God. See, we want to get out from under God, and so we sin, and then we'll stay in that sin because we want to stay away from God. We know what God requires. God wants us to confess our sins and forsake our sins, put our mortal deeds to death, that kind of thing. He wants us to die to self daily and all that. And we say, no, don't want to do it. I'd rather live in the far country, far from God. So the sinful state is a departure and distance from God. But not only that, the sinful state is a spending state. It's a spending state. You notice that he wasted his substance, verse 13. Verse 14 said, and when he had spent all, there arose a mighty famine in the land. It's a spending state. Can I get you to go to the book of Ecclesiastes? Remember, Psalms is about in the middle of your Bible. Proverbs comes after that, and then Ecclesiastes. Ecclesiastes 9 and verse 18. Ecclesiastes number chapter 9 and verse number 18. Here's what God's Word says. Ecclesiastes chapter 9, verse 18. Wisdom is better than weapons of war, but one sinner destroyeth much good. It's a spending state. One sinner can destroy much good. You folks realize that somebody could come into our church harboring sin in their life, just one person, and ruin this entire church? I was sharing with John Bailey this past week about one man and his wife came into the church, and wow, did they tear up that church. Boy, what they did to that church. Church was doing fine, going, growing. Building a new building and everything. Because of one sinner. Yeah, the sinful state's a spending state. Wasteful spending here. He wasted his life. Not only that, but when we come back here to Luke chapter 15, we find that the sinful state is a wanting state. It said there that after he'd spent all, there arose a mighty famine in that land, and he began to be in want. See, a sinful state is one where you keep wanting more, and you want more, and this didn't satisfy, so you want more. That's where the Lord Jesus Christ satisfies. Amen? You know, he satisfies. But the sinful state's a wanting state. We're in want. Got to have something. And because we've spent all, now we've got to figure out some way to get it all back. A wanting state. But we see also here, fourthly, that the sinful state is a servile state or a servant state. We become servants to sin, is what the Bible talks about. And you see that this fellow here in Luke chapter 15, you know, it said in verse 15, and he went and joined himself to a citizen of that country, and he sent him into his fields to feed swine. Yeah, he became a servant to this guy, and not fun job. Can you imagine a Jewish person having to feed hogs, feed the swine? They didn't want anything to do with them. It's a terrible thing. The reason why we saw that, remember when Jesus cast the devils out and the devils went into those swine, then all the swine ran over the cliff into the sea and had everybody all upset. What those people were doing were they were raising those swine to sell to the Roman army. And that's why they were doing that, for food, to feed the soldiers, the meat for them. But otherwise, they wouldn't have anything to do with it. And of course, where did that take place? Samaria. So we've got here this servile state, but here fifthly, the sinful state is a perpetual dissatisfaction. The sinful state is a perpetual dissatisfaction. Was he happy there in that far country? Was he happy there that he had joined himself to the citizen of that country? Was he happy that he was in the fields to feed the swine? Was he happy that he didn't have anything to eat but the husks that the swine did eat? No, it was a perpetual dissatisfaction. People that are in sin, they're always dissatisfied. Nothing pleases them. I'm going to have you go back this time to the book of Proverbs. You found Ecclesiastes, so I'm sure you can get there to the book of Proverbs, chapter 13 and verse 15. Book of Proverbs, chapter 13 and verse 15. This is what God's word says here in Proverbs 13 and 15. It says this: good understanding giveth favor, but the way of transgressors is hard. Everything about it is a difficulty for them. No matter what they do, it's a hard life. A servile state. Now go with me to the book of Ezekiel. Remember, right after you get through all those, you got Isaiah, and then you got Jeremiah and Lamentations, and Ezekiel chapter 7 and verse number 9, if you would please. Ezekiel chapter 7 and verse 19. I said 9, I'm sorry, I was wrong. Verse 19 says this, Ezekiel 7, 19. They shall cast their silver in the streets, and their gold shall be removed. Their silver and their gold shall not be able to deliver them in the day of the wrath of the Lord. They shall not satisfy their souls, neither fill their bowels, because it is the stumbling block of their iniquity. The sinful state is a perpetual dissatisfaction. Nothing's going to satisfy them. Nothing will fill them. Nothing. As we come back to this younger son in our parable of the prodigal son, extravagant in his self-indulgence, here's a sixth thing. The sinful state cannot get relief from creatures. The sinful state cannot get relief from creatures, animals, or men. And you notice that he said here, verse 16, he would fain have filled his belly with the husks that the swine did eat, and no man gave unto him. No matter what he does, no relief. Nobody really is going to help, because the only thing that can help is get rid of the sin. That's the only thing that'll work. It's like Pilgrim in Pilgrim's Progress. He's carrying around this big bag of weight of sin on his back, and it keeps getting bigger and heavier because of that sin. The only thing that'll help is when that sin is gone under the blood by the Lord Jesus Christ. A sinful state. Here's another thing about the sinful state. The sinful state is a lost state. How do I know that? Because the Father said, "For this was my son." You know, he was lost and is found. It's a lost state. You know, you're not in the house of God. You're not where you ought to be in your sin. And also, the sinful state is a state of death. "For this my son was dead and is alive again." People think they're alive. Oh boy, oh boy, oh boy, they're at this party and they're having all this fun, and they're dead. They're at this game having all this fun. Boy, they're just, wow, but they're dead. They're dead in trespasses and sins. Their body's alive, but they're dead. That part inside of them that could worship God's dead. That part that would be in full communion with God is dead because they're in a sinful state. But the last of these that I have, the sinful state is one of insanity. The sinful state is one of insanity. Go with me to the book of Ecclesiastes again, chapter 9 and verse number 3. Remember, it was Psalms, Proverbs, Ecclesiastes. Chapter 9 and verse number 3. And here's what it says. Ecclesiastes 9:3. There is an evil among all things that are done under the sun, that there is one event unto all. Yea, also the heart of the sons of men is full of evil, and madness is in their heart while they live, and after that they go to the dead. Madness is in their heart. Folks, the state of sin is one of insanity. Why does the Bible here say in Luke chapter number 15 and verse number 17, and when he came to himself? Remember in Luke chapter 8 and verse 35, Jesus had crossed the Sea of Galilee. They came to that region of the Gadarenes. And you remember there in Luke chapter 8 verse 35 that there was a man that lived in the tombs. Other places in Scripture say they tried to bind him and they couldn't bind him, and that he was naked and would cut himself and run around. And a lot like today. I was amazed at the mall yesterday. We're inside the mall, near naked. A lot of the people were. It just was amazing to me. They're not in their right mind. And verse 35 says, and when they went out to see what was done and came to Jesus and found the man out of whom the devils were departed, sitting at the feet of Jesus, clothed and in his right mind, and they were afraid. In his right mind. To stay in sin is insanity. To stay lost without Jesus Christ is insanity. Come to yourself. Come to your right mind. Get things right. Extravagant. But number 4, he was extravagant in his return. He was extravagant in his return, this younger son. See, affliction made him repent. You know, sometimes God puts us through some hard times to make us understand we need to repent. Affliction here made him repent. You know, does God have to take you or take me to some place where he puts me through something hard so I'll repent? You know, we ought to be more sensitive than that. In Sunday school, we were looking at that idea of a seared conscience. Ought not to have that. Ought to be sensitive to the Holy Spirit's prompting and leading. You know, this affliction, all that he went through, the famine in the land. He's got no money. He's a hired servant there. He's feeding swine. He's got nothing to eat. Because verse 17 at the very end of it says, "And I perish with hunger." God had to bring him through some affliction here, you know, so that he would repent. And so he considered the life that he would have. You notice that verse 17, he said, "How many hired servants of my father's have bread enough and to spare? And I perish with hunger." Everything at the father's house was better than what he had with the swine. You know, a lot of times we don't think about that with sin, but everything holy and godly and wonderful with God, a lot better than anything this old world or this flesh or the devil can offer. Amen. He came to himself and said, "Hey, wait a minute, at my father's house, a lot better than where I am now. In the near country, not the far country, amen?" They had bread. It said there, "The hired servants of my father's have bread." Isn't that something how God when he set up the temple and, well, the tabernacle in the wilderness first, and then of course they duplicated it in the temple. But when he set up that tabernacle, one of the things that he did purposely was inside of that tabernacle, he had a table of showbread. He put 12 loaves of bread every day on that table of showbread to show the people of Israel God would take care of their every need. But you don't get that in a far country. He's going to eat the husks. Isn't that something? Eat the husks that the swine did eat. No man gave him anything. But God would take care of him. Not only did the hired servants do well under the Father and had bread, but they had bread to spare. I mean, God's mercy and grace goes way beyond just us. He's got it for everybody that wants it. If every single person in the whole planet repented all at once and wanted to have Jesus Christ be their Savior, why, what a day that'd be. Wouldn't that be something? If they did, God'd still have enough grace and have grace to spare. He'd have bread left over. He'd never run out. He's rich in mercy. I mean, God is rich in his mercy and in his grace. And he'd be able to give all of that to them if they wanted it. And then he realized also that the hired servants there, no matter how low their job was, they were provided for. From the lowest servant to the highest servant, every one of them taken care of. No matter what their job was, and you can imagine back in those days what some of the lowly jobs would have been, they're all taken care of. But here's another thing that he realized. When he was considering what the hired servants had, he realized this. It's worth it to be humble. It's worth it to humble ourselves and come back. It's worth it to grovel there at the foot of his Father and say that he sinned and he's no longer worthy to be a son, and take me back anyway, every way. Please take me back, to humble ourselves. It's humbling to confess our sin, isn't it? To admit our sin, and to admit it's us. See, we always want our sin to say, well, if they didn't do this, if they hadn't done that, if this hadn't happened in my life, if this thing didn't come about, you know, that's why I did it. If you didn't do, if they, you know, instead of just saying, yep, I'm the one that did it.
Mm-hmm. That's right.
On my own. Doesn't matter anything, any circumstances, but that's humbling to do that. We don't want to do that often. We don't like doing that. But this son was willing to do that. He didn't say anything about, well, Father, you were hard. You know, and that's why I wanted to get out from under your rule. You know, Father, you were, you know, so terrible with your money, I thought I ought to handle the money in the family. I mean, he didn't say any of that. He said, I've sinned. I've sinned before heaven and before you. I've sinned. So he proposed to go back here. He had the purpose to do it. You know, anybody that wants to come to know the Lord Jesus Christ as Savior, they've got to do it. They can't wait for somebody else to do it. They can't have me come down, wait, let me grab your hand, let me hold your hand and bring you up here. You know, drag you kicking, you know, that kind of thing. No, you've got to want to. Ask Jesus Christ to be your Savior. You know, and that's what this young man did. He purposed to go back. I'm going to go back to my Father. And that's what verse 18, I will arise and go to my Father. He purposed it. And he had to openly repent to come back. He had to confess his fault that he was guilty. And say unto him, Father, I have sinned against heaven and before thee. I'm no more worthy to be called thy son. That's pretty extravagant, don't you think? Pretty far out there to do that, but that's what he had to do. That's what God had called him to do, showed him when he got in his right mind. He would judge himself also by saying that he's not worthy of sonship. He judged himself. He said, here's the level I'm at. See, there's a lot of people that go to God and they say, well, God, I've been pretty good. yeah, I've done this thing wrong and I've done that thing wrong, but God, overall, I'm a pretty good person. You really ought to take me as one of your children into heaven. You ought, really ought to. I deserve to go to heaven. No, we deserve hell. Every single one of us, the first time that we sinned, when we were small little children and disobeyed, or small little children and took something that wasn't ours, small little children and got angry when we shouldn't have gotten angry, small little children and we told a lie. As soon as we did that when we were small little children, God should have sent us to hell right then. But he let us live long enough to hear my voice right now today. And you know what else in this whole thing of repentance this fellow was extravagant in? He said he would go back and he wanted to be a hired servant. He said, verse 19, make me one of thy hired servants. Any menial position would be good enough. Anything would. And look with me, Psalm 84 and verse number 10. Psalm 84, verse number 10. Some people are too proud to have menial tasks in a church. Guess what, folks? If we get a church building, it's going to get dirty, and somebody's going to have to clean it. Guess what? Somebody's going to get the bathroom dirty. Look what it says here. Psalm 84, verse 10. For a day in thy courts is better than a thousand. A thousand what? In the far country. A thousand in the pig pen. Amen. A day in thy courts is better than a thousand. I had rather be a doorkeeper in the house of my God than to dwell in the tents of wickedness. It'd be better for me to just be the doorstop. You know, just that little wedge, you know? Just that little wedge that keeps the door open. That'd be better. That job would be better for me than to dwell in the tents of wickedness. Menial. He said the least little thing would be a great thing for him. And he also was extravagant here. He said he would recognize his father as father. You notice he came back to him and he verse 18, I will arise and go to my father and say unto him, Father. I'll actually call him Father. He'd recognize his father as father. Remember, before he wanted to get out from under him. Wanted to get out from under Israel. Didn't want any more to do with his father. I disown you. You're as good as dead. Give me your inheritance. Now he's going to call him father with some respect. He's extravagant because he actually did these things. Verse 20, it says, and he arose and came to his father. I've got more extravagant, but we're going to take it up next week. It's extravagant on the Father's part, what we'll see starting next week, if you'll hang in there with me. Riotous living, not a good place to be. Amen? Amen. Not a good place to be. That sinful state's a difficult thing to be in. But out of the insanity of being in sin, this younger son came to himself, came back to his father. How about you? Do you understand what sin is and what it does to you and how important it is for you to come to the Father through Jesus Christ, his son? Let's bow our heads together. Got our heads bowed and our eyes closed. I don't know. Maybe there's somebody here today that doesn't know Jesus Christ as Savior.
Maybe they're just like this younger son. Tired of their father's rule, tired of, you know, not having the fun of the world, and then gets out there. That sinful state's a hard state to be in. Would you repent? Admit your sin, call it what it is, just call it lies, or using God's name as a swear word, or, you know, stealing something, or hatred, or whatever. Just call it what it is. Don't blame anybody else about it. You decided to engage in it. And just come before God. Maybe somebody by way of the internet would look in, watch, and you too confess your sins and turn from them, repent, ask Jesus Christ to be your Savior. Won't you, where you are right now, young or old, doesn't matter, be honest before God and cry out to God and say, God, yes, indeed, I'm a sinner. I've done things that deserve hell. But today, would you please be merciful to me, a sinner, and save me by the blood of Jesus Christ. Give me that grace and that mercy that you're so rich in, that I might have eternal life, and I want to live for you and serve you with my life. Become Lord and Master of me. I turn myself over to you. That's what this son did. Are you willing to do it? You that know Christ as your Savior, do you live for him? Or has Satan gotten you out into a far country? There's no comfort there. It's only dissatisfaction. Come on back. Father, we thank you for your word. Just continue to help us that we might serve you well. Lord, we love you and praise you for all you are and all you do. And please, I pray that some would come to know you as Savior. For without that, they'll have nothing. The riotous living does no good. But being a servant of the Heavenly Father is a great place to be. Please, I pray that you'd do some great things, even now, in Jesus' name. Amen. Men, take your hymn books, 465. Cleanse Me is the title of it. 465. If you would, we'll stand. We'll sing this as a hymn of invitation. If there's something God's spoken to you about, you need to take care of it, do it now, please. If it's something that you're not sure about, you'd like to see from the Word of God how you can know Jesus as your Savior, just come on up and we'll show you from God's Word how to be saved today. You that are there in the audience of the internet, won't you trust Jesus Christ as your Savior, please? Search me, O God, are the words of Cleanse Me. Here we go.
Search me, O God, and know my heart today. Try me, O Savior, know my thoughts, I pray. See if there be some way. Lord, take my life. self and pride. I now surrender, Lord, in me abide.
Got one more stanza. God's speaking to you about something. You need to take care of it today. Don't leave here, because as soon as you walk out of this building, then there'll be distractions, there'll be other things. God wants you to be saved if you're not saved. God wants you to be right with Him today if you're not right. If there's something that you're harboring in your heart, get rid of it today and cleanse me here. Let's sing that fourth stanza, and please act on it if you would.
Oh, Holy Ghost, revival comes from Thee. Send a revival, start the work in me. Thy word declares, Thou wilt supply our need. For blessing now, O Lord, I humbly plead.
Let's bow our heads once again. Put our hymn books down. Saints, be praying. God might work in a great way. We don't know how. John, would you close us in prayer, please?
Lord Jesus, the devil seeks to keep us in a far country, to keep us from returning home. He seeks to deceive, to think that far country promises more than what you offer. And Lord, all it leads to is destruction and death, dissatisfaction. And we pray, Lord, that if there be souls here today that haven't sought you, haven't fallen into that lost nature, or not recognized it, Lord, that they're in a far country, that all they have to do, Lord, is to come to themselves, come out of the madness, and to return to you, Lord. Just turn and repent. And believe on you, Lord, that when they return, that they'll be forgiven. There won't be any questions asked about what they've done. And I just pray, Lord, that you move mightily through the power of thy Holy Spirit to convict souls of their lost nature. They're far from you in sin, Lord. And that you're willing and able and full of compassion to run to them. It won't be the sinner running to the Father. It's the Father running the sinner, yes. And having compassion. And then all that's given, Lord, to that sinner in that time, they're reinstated into the family. They're given everything back and more. And I just pray, Lord, that there be souls that will understand their lost nature, that they're far away, but if they just return, they can have eternal life, abundant life from you, Lord, while we're still here. The opportunity to serve you and love you while we're here. So I pray, Lord, for victory in you, that lost souls return to you, Lord, and those that are saved, Lord, will get out of the far country and draw nigh to you and repent and confess the sins in their lives and turn it over to you, Lord, so that we may abide close with you, that we may be guided and directed by you in every way to serve you through thy Holy Spirit. So I pray, Lord, for a great revival to take place here, surrounding us, our families, and in our country and our nation, that you would move mightily in these last days to save souls, Lord, and help us to draw nigh to you so that we may serve you better in that realm. We thank you and praise you, Lord Jesus, for all that you do and are doing for all of us. In thy holy name, amen.
Amen. Amen. Lord bless you, dear ones. Thank you for being here. We'll see you this afternoon.